We'll go whenever you are. Sync clap?
Yeah, go on, sync clap, please.
Yep. That was shocking.
Terrible.
There we go.
Chris, here we are at Burnley's training ground. Joe and I are feeling the cold a little bit, but you evidently not. Shorts and T-shirt.
No, well, you get used to it being up here.
Do you?
Yeah, Manchester and up north is a bit more wet and cold.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we're quite used to it, other than you southerners are probably a bit like the weather and like the heat down south.
We do like the heat down south. Yeah. Let's talk about you and your journey, because we are here. You're a Premier League footballer now, of course. But let's start right back when you were a young kid in New Zealand. How big was football for you growing up? Because I'm guessing you played other sports as well.
Yeah, I did. I grew up playing rugby. I grew up playing cricket as well. But football was always my main one. My dad played football, so that's how I got into it from a young age. But football's very big as kids growing up. So from 5 to 13, it's massive. It's one of the biggest kids sport in the country. So everybody goes into it. It's once you hit 11, 12, 13, that's when rugby takes over.
Does it?
You're going into schools and you're getting, not pressured, but you're getting told this is what you should play. And that's why we're so good at it, because everybody's like, well, we see the All Blacks, we want to be like them. Mm. They just play it. So yeah, it's one of those things that's massive when it's young, and if people follow it through, it's better.
Were you playing rugby and football? Because obviously I've read that you developed quite early. You were a big lad from a young age. Were you playing football and rugby at a good level?
Played a bit of both. Rugby not really at a good level. I just played through the schools. That was just because I got bullied.
Really?
Yeah, I got bullied for playing football. So
I was bullied for playing football?
For playing football. So that's the difference. It's like if you're in England and you play some other sport,
yeah,
you get bullied for not playing football, don't you? But back in New Zealand, if you don't play rugby, I got bullied. So I was like, well, I'm a big lad, I'm not having this. So I showed them and knocked a few of them about, and then it was a bit of respect came back.
Wow.
Because they're like, wow, we ain't messing with them.
So. He's a big lad.
I think it was just because I was lucky. I was 6 foot by the time I was 13.
Wow, six foot.
That
13.
Is massive.
Around
that's about
huge.
That. Yeah, I was a big, well, maybe not 6 foot, but I was big for my age, yeah. Definitely. But I was playing men's football by the time I was 14 and a half, 15. And then, of course, my career took off from there.
And obviously you come from quite a sporty household. Your sister's an incredibly good footballer as well, yeah, isn't she? When you were growing up, who was better, you or your sister in the back garden?
Well, she's always much technically better than me. Yeah, she's very good that side of it. I'm more of the hustle and bustle, know where the ball's going to drop in the box and, yeah, and score goals. So I've always had that knack, which is nice. But she was more a technical centre midfielder, defensive midfielder type of player. So yeah, we're quite lucky being able to represent New Zealand in a World Cup, especially
amazing,
in the A group, which is quality, and we both had really nice careers. But yeah, it's just a nice sporty household.
You were also playing second tier football, were you, in New Zealand? And I read a story that you were getting paid £100 every time you scored a goal.
Yeah, so that's a bit of a funny story. My very close friends, the Hobans back in Cambridge, when I was 13, one of my best mates' dads was the assistant coach for the Cambridge football team.
Yeah.
And he ever said, like, well, whenever you make it into the first team, I'll pay you $100 for every goal you score.
Wow. Big mistake.
Yeah, big mistake. I was 14 when I made my debut for them.
Did you become very selfish at that point, just never passing the ball?
Yeah, it's always the way. So I was 14 to score my first goal, and he ultimately regretted it very soon. Luckily enough, he kicked me out of the club very quickly and pushed me on to better things.
And looking at your career path, Chris, obviously you said you had success in New Zealand at a young age, you were physically big at a young age, but it looks to me that your big sort of shot came when you were offered a trial at West Brom.
Yeah.
How did that all come about? Because I think you're only the fifth player at the time from New Zealand to play in the Premier League, so it's quite a big step geographically, if nothing else. How did that all come about?
That's huge. But yeah, back in New Zealand, there was a guy called Roger Wilkinson. He was my coach for Waikato and for Hamilton Wanderers. So he had a few contacts at West Brom, Millwall, and one of my family friends had a contact at Everton. So he was like, well, I'd like to set you up with a trial if you're all right with that. I was like, of course, I'll have a go over there and see what happens. And so he organised a two-week trial, came over here, done quite well in the trial, and they offered me a two-year scholarship. And I just took their hand and said yes.
You're a young kid at the time. You're moving from New Zealand to England, which is miles away. I mean, what was going through your mind? Obviously, the excitement of potentially making it pro, but there must have been a lot of challenges as well at that point.
Look, I think a Kiwi coming from New Zealand, we're very laid back people. Right. If you ever get out there, we're totally relaxed. We do everything at our own pace. We're enjoying life. We have a good time. And that's just what we are. We are right. Literally chill. And to be fair, at 16, 17, 18, I didn't understand what I gave up. I was just moving to play football. Right. Moving. It felt like I'm just moving to a different club. My mum moved over with me. She's English. So it was basically still living at home because I still had my mother's cooking. My mum to, when I had a bad day, go home to shout at and scream at.
So you just put your mum over to do the cooking, to shout at, any other reasons?
And she had the password, of course. So that's the main thing.
Wow.
But no, it just makes it easy because if you go into digs, it's very tough because you have a bad day, you come home, you can't scream at your digs people, or like, not scream at them, but like, you know, you just
take
have a bad
out your
day.
Frustration.
You just emotionally, you have to try and be happy all the time in front of them and be respectful. Whereas some days you just want to be like, look, leave me alone. I just want to sit on the couch and just get this day out of the way with. So I think it was very fortunate I did it. My parents came over when I was young, and I think it helped me extremely much.
And what was it like that day? You talked about it just then, signing that professional contract. Did you feel like, yes, I finally made it?
Look, I don't think I've ever fancied I've finally made it until I was about 25, 26 when I thought, yes, I'm going to have a good long career in here and I'm going to hopefully see out my time until I'm 35 playing professional football. Still, when you're 17, 18, you're thinking, well, I've only signed 2 years. I need to keep going. I want the next one. I want to keep going bigger. I want to get to the bigger deals, the bigger clubs, and just express yourself and force yourself in the first team. It was nice. I mean, Tony Mowbray gave me my debut in my first year as a scholar, which was lucky. And then Di Matteo took over when we went down to the championship and really helped my career because he trained me as a player and helped me learn and adapt. And then ultimately gave me a lot of game time as well.
What were those days like? You said you're very laid back, very chill, but when you're making your debut, when you're coming over here, that first moment, you must have felt the pressure and the nerves a little bit on those days.
To be fair, my debut is a very big blur.
Really?
Yeah, from the moment the gaffer, Tony Mowbray, turned around and said to me, Woody, you're coming on. From that moment to about halfway through I was playing, I can't remember a thing really. It's just a blur.
What?
It's just like a...
Because of the nerves, is that?
Yeah, I think it was just because of the nerves. Yeah. Just, it was a bit of a roar of like, oh, what's happening? This is not right. I'm a 17-year-old kid. I'm like, from New Zealand, this has never really happened.
Yeah.
It was a bit of a blur, and then I started to enjoy it. And then, of course, I was training with the first team every single day, so I started to improve end over end over end, and it was just fantastic.
You went to West Brom, you've signed pro, you've become a professional footballer, dreams years in the making, you've succeeded that. You then went on 6 loans from West Brom and all over the country. So looking at where you went, South Coast, North Coast, the Midlands. How did you find that? You just wanted to see it all?
You just wanted to see the country.
You said to them, I need to see the South Coast.
I need to see a bit of everything.
Well, you achieved that, because you did go everywhere. How did you find that?
Of course, going to a different club every single so often is tough, meeting new people, blending with new people and things like that, but ultimately it was what I had to do.
And obviously, was there any one specific loan that you remember thinking, this is a real changing point for me, I'm learning a lot here and scoring a lot of goals?
There's two probably. Birmingham, when I went to Birmingham on loan.
Yeah. When you were playing in the Europa League as well,
then,
weren't you?
Yeah, when I was playing in the Europa League, it was funny, it was an extremely different experience. It was quite weird because, of course, we're in the championship and things like that, playing Saturday, Tuesday, and then it came Saturday, Tuesday, Thursday, Sunday,
crazy.
Wednesday again. It was ridiculous, but it was good because it was a different experience.
Yeah.
So that was fantastic. Really enjoyed my time there, and we done quite well. And then, of course, Millwall, I think, is where my career took off. Basically, I scored 11 and 19 games, and that's when I got my move to Leicester, and just progressed from there, which was fantastic.
Who do you think has had the biggest influence on your career in terms of management?
It's hard to put them down to like one of them because I think they all give you something different.
Right.
It's the same with like Roy Hodgson when I was at West Brom. There's little things they teach you over the days and over the weeks where you pick up on them and you remember that point. And I think everyone gives you a different outcome. Same with Gary Monk at Leeds. He gave me the confidence to be able to push on and be a great striker and things like that. So you just take as much as you can from every manager and bring it into your own game and just work it into yourself.
Your next progression, how do you look back on your time at Leeds? Because you had a good run of form at Leeds as well.
Yeah, I had a great second year at Leeds. We've done fantastically well, finishing 7th. I mean, the last few years before that, Leeds had only finished 15th, 16th and things like that, quite struggling. But it was fantastic. As the club progressed, I progressed as well. And I had a great time there. I loved my time there because they're a great, great group of lads. There's great staff and great chairman. And of course, the fan base, when they're behind you, they are one of the best in the world. Turning down that chance of playing in the Premier League is something which would be extremely hard, I think, for any player. I did think Leeds would get promoted in the next couple of seasons. I truly believe that. But I couldn't turn down the chance of playing Premiership football. If Leeds were in the Premiership, I would never have left. I really enjoyed my time there, and it's nice to see them doing so well, and hopefully they're up here.
So obviously you've just signed for Burnley. What did Sean Dyche tell you when he first arrived? What was he expecting from you as a player?
Expecting was just the enjoyment of freedom to hopefully go and score goals and express what he said. He'd been following my career for over the years, progressing, thinking he did try and sign me a couple of years before and just didn't work out.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
When you were at Leeds, when you first came?
Not when I was first at Leeds. I think I was at Leicester or just coming out of Millwall, something around then.
Okay.
It just didn't work out. But it was one of those, he'd been following my career and he said, well, now I think you're the right personality and the right timing to now kick on and become a good player. And so he just gave me that confidence. And then, of course, I came in, done quite well in my first couple of games. Yeah. And ever since then, I haven't looked back. But ultimately, he gives you the confidence to just be the player you are.
And let's talk about your international career, because you went to the World Cup as an 18-year-old, the youngest member of that New Zealand squad. Tell us what that was like to process as an 18-year-old, representing your country on the biggest stage of them all.
Yeah, I mean, it was fantastic. I mean, playing in the World Cup is anybody's dream, especially as an international. It's where you want to go. It's where you want to take your career and hopefully test yourself against some of the best players in the world.
And of course, we mentioned that only the fifth player from New Zealand to make it in the Premier League, youngest player at the World Cup in the New Zealand squad, also the youngest captain ever for New Zealand. Quite a lot to be proud of there, I want to mention them.
Yeah, hugely. I mean, just playing for my country makes me extremely proud and honoured. To be only the fifth Kiwi ever to play in the Premiership is a huge thing. It's hard to get over from New Zealand and to apply yourself in the top leagues and your trade over here is very hard to do. But ultimately, playing for your national team is what you dream of.
I want to mention quite a unique incident that happened to you quite recently, January. You broke your nose. You then played 90 minutes after that, scored. 90 minutes after that, scored against big clubs, Chelsea and Man United. Yeah. But can you explain what happened after the games? You just come through two 90 minutes with a broken nose. What happened after that?
So yeah, it was unfortunate. I broke my nose against Chelsea. Had to play on throughout the whole game. Extremely tough. I couldn't really see and all of that. But it was something we had to do because we had to fight and things like that. Played two full games. Didn't have a touch on my nose at all.
Scored in both games as
well. Scored in both games, luckily, and things like that. Not one knock at all. Coming to the end of the game, we're all happy and celebrating. Mizo comes running over to congratulate us and shoulder barges me in the nose.
And this is at Old Trafford.
At Old Trafford, my eyes.
And your teammate has injured your nose.
Yeah, injured my nose, starts bleeding again, going all over the place. My eyes start to well up with water because it started hurting again. It's ridiculous. So I was like, well, thanks, Mizo. I just got through two games without being touched. And you big lump come over and shoulder barge me in the nose and mess it all up again.
And finally, looking back on your career, proudest moment of Chris Wood's career so far, what would you say it is?
Premiership debut or national team debut, I think they're both up there. Extremely proud moments and something I'll cherish for the rest of my life.
Love that, Chris. Absolute pleasure. Thank you for your time, mate.
Thank you very much.
That was, of course, Making It Pro with Chris Wood. Thanks to EA Sports, FIFA 20.